Good evening. As President of the Academy, it is my distinct pleasure to call to order the 2099th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Since our organization's founding in 1780, members of the American Academy have gathered to discuss ideas related to philosophy, technology, aesthetics, and community, conversations that reflect the breadth of our membership and the scope of our mission. Tonight's program is an opportunity to hear from an Academy member whose work truly sits at the intersection of the arts and sciences. Architect Jeanne Gang is the founding principal and partner of Studio Gang, an international architecture and urban design practice headquartered in Chicago. Gang's work has been recognized for challenging the aesthetic and technical possibilities of her field. She's a pioneer whose inquisitive, forward-looking approach expands the active role of designers in building a better, more just society. Her work includes major projects throughout the Americas and Europe, including cultural institutions like the Writers Theater, community-oriented spaces like Chicago's Aqua Tower. Under her leadership, Studio Gang is currently focused on exciting new projects, including an expansion of the American Museum of Natural History and a unified campus for California College of the Arts. Jeanne is a fellow of the American Institute of Architects, a recipient of the Cooper Hewitt National Design Award, and was named a MacArthur Fellow in 2011. She's also a professor of the practice at Harvard Graduate School of Design. She was elected to the American Academy in 2017. In addition to her built work, Jeanne has made tremendous contributions to the theory and literature of her field. Under her leadership, Studio Gang has developed research, publications, and exhibitions related to what Jeanne calls a practice of actionable idealism, a theory that pushes design's ability to create public awareness and give rise to change. Jeanne's contributions to design are perhaps best described by her fellow Academy member, actress and playwright Anna Deavere Smith, who wrote in Time Magazine's 2019 100 Most Influential People issue that, for Jeanne, architecture is not just a wondrous object, it is a catalyst for change. Jeanne's commitment to the idea that our physical spaces can be in service to the common good is evocative of concepts in the work of the American Academy's Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship. That commission conducted dozens of listening sessions with Americans from across the political spectrum to hear about their experiences and frustrations in engaging in their democracy. One clear piece of feedback was that people are hungry for opportunities and spaces in which to assemble, deliberate, and converse with each other. The commission's final report, Our Common Purpose, Reinventing Democracy for the 21st Century, incorporates this feedback by calling on the United States to dramatically expand its civic bridging capacity so that Americans can better practice the art of association. Strengthening civic infrastructure, parks, libraries, museums, and programming that have the capacity to connect disparate segments of our society is an essential step in renewing our connection to one another. By developing spaces where we can come together, we will be better able to commit to a shared sense of the common good. Our Common Purpose calls for the creation of a national trust for civic infrastructure, which would empower communities across the country to realize their visions while ensuring that new investments are made with an eye towards civic health and equity. It is essential that new civic infrastructure focuses on communities and geographies that have been historically marginalized and underserved. Whether through her public parks or her urban residential towers, Jeanne Gang's approach is a beautiful illustration of how to honor the values of civic engagement and social justice when designing for the future. I'm delighted that she's here today to discuss her work. And now, please join me in welcoming Jeanne Gang.
Thank you so much, David. I'm really excited to be able to share some thoughts on public space with the Academy tonight. Thank you for this invitation. I'm going to go right to my slides, and hopefully everyone can see that. Just a little background first on my practice. I created Studio Gang. It's an architecture and urbanism practice over two decades ago, and we now have offices in many cities, and we've been working across a large spectrum of projects. Including tall buildings like the Aqua Tower in Chicago, but museums also like the American Museum of Natural History, where we designed a new wing that is under construction in New York, and places like the Writers Theater, which is a theater, but also a civic space, higher education spaces like these residence hall for universities and academic buildings like University of Chicago Campus North project seen here. And now a large transportation project for Chicago, this new Chicago Airport International Terminal. But along my path, I've also really been interested in activating communities. And our practice is really focused on urban centers with an emphasis on how architecture and urban design can come together to create stronger social connections and a better public spaces for everyone. In fact, in all of our projects, even with the tall towers, we are really looking for ways to connect communities, to create environments that reduce climate change, create better outcomes that are welcoming for everyone. And so with that said, I hope tonight we can think about what will be our next public spaces and how can they help us to mend social divides. The pandemic, I guess, has provided us with a perfect example of how all space can be manipulated to discourage social interaction. Seats placed 6 feet apart, benches taken away, turned over upside down. And, you know, this physical distancing that has been necessary due to the pandemic was somehow, unfortunately, termed social distancing. And this really is lamentable because social relationships in public space are exactly what we need. We need open access of public spaces and their ability to produce spontaneity, intermixing that will help us to overcome dichotomies in our society and combat loneliness and to bring us closer to nature. And well, with that, by extension, to combat climate change. So while the pandemic enforced physical distances, it was in fact public space, large, flexible, open spaces that saved the day. It made physical distancing possible. And during the last year, they were used for outdoor activities where people could spread out. You know, even we saw theater, we saw many different uses of these outdoor spaces that are in the public realm, the shared space. It wasn't always that these resources were available. I also think that, you know, large public demonstrations, such an important element of our democracy, the pandemic showed the importance of these flexible spaces that add resilience to our society. I also think there's a possibility of expanding our notion of what is public space on the indoor realm or semi-public space, and this will gain importance in the future. So while in the recent past, semi-public indoor space, like shopping malls, for example, have focused on consumption, now we have a chance to think about expanding access to indoor public space and outdoor public space that isn't just about consumption. So if we think back about our resources, you know, it wasn't always the case that the shared public resources, such as this is a picture of Lake Michigan and Chicago with the waterfront, not like only 100 years ago, was completely dominated by industry and private uses. And in less than 100 years, it really transformed into, you know, kind of a jewel of a shared space in Chicago. That is enviable, like, you know, quality of life, and brings this kind of flexibility that I'm talking about. But for me, when I first built my practice, it wasn't on this glorious lakefront. It was really in the Chicago neighborhoods. And my first projects were in the neighborhoods, community centers, actually. And so when I started looking at community centers, we made this kind of observation and realization. On the left, you see a map of the city of Chicago that is mapped out by race and ethnicity. And this is something Chicago loves to do about itself. It's a city of neighborhoods. And they do it and update it regularly. And then on the right, you see a map that we drew. And it was really interesting to see the correlation. The tan areas are these neighborhoods that have no dashes, little black dashes in them, The black dashes represent what the AIA considers significant architecture. So you might have heard of food deserts, but there, in a way, if you look at this frame of reference of the AIA, there are architecture deserts as well. Why are not interesting architecture being built into these neighborhoods? And so one of my first projects was this community center in Chinatown, which, you know, basically listening to the communities where there wasn't very much investment, I learned and met people from different ethnic backgrounds and learned what mattered to them. And so here it was really about intergenerational connections and needing to make those. And we built spaces that overlapped generations. This is another building that we designed, an early building in the Chicago's Auburn Gresham neighborhood. It's the SOS International. It's a foster care organization that helps to reunite children who are put into foster care that are siblings. And this was their community center. And it was really, I think it's interesting that in these kind of projects, everything was leftovers or, you know, donations. Even the land was this little sliver of land between two rail lines here. And all the materials we had to use for the building were, you know, donated from various sources. And so even the concrete, which was an idea that we had to express and make visible the donations, was from big projects that were downtown Chicago. Like, how can we, you know, show that there's this kind of giving and make that very visible in the work? So we layered into the strata wall the different types of concrete, which show in the final project. I think the other big point of our work is this aspect of the environment and care for the environment and social fabric together. And they come together in this public realm. This was a project that was never built, but it was one of the most influential projects for me and my practice, called the Ford Calumet Environmental Center. And the idea of it was that it could be a place for learning green jobs. And this was a competition done by the city of Chicago. And when we first started it, we looked at this overall context, you know, and the motto of start with what's there. We learned that there were a lot of older industrial areas overlap with this important migratory flyway for birds and birds that come from all the way from South America. And so maybe this building, we suppose, could be kind of built like a nest with reusing things that were available and nearby, like a bird would build a nest, and therefore reducing the carbon and the embodied carbon in the building. And so this project was really about reusing those things, but also protecting birds. One of the discoveries was that, you know, something like more than a billion birds die every year in North America colliding with glass that they cannot see. So when I learned this in this project, I suddenly thought, oh, I don't want to be, you know, how can architects be people who are designing buildings that kill birds? So we addressed that through this kind of screen that really protects the glass from the outside and creates an interesting space for people. And then these are column clusters made of variable types of steel. And then this assembly space, so like an indoor public space for people to gather, for people to exchange ideas, very close to this natural industrial environment of Calumet. And together, it just creates this real synthesis of people and environment, reducing carbon, both operational and embodied carbon. Another project I wanted to touch on that has to do with like kind of a semi-public space on the inside of a building is this project for Beloit College. It's called the Powerhouse. And Beloit College is a small liberal arts college you can see here located on this hill in Beloit, Wisconsin. And this is the Rock River, you know, very close to where I grew up actually in Belvidere, Illinois. And the Powerhouse was always this very strong element within the community. between town and gown. It was like a piece of infrastructure for both. These are some views of it from the various additions that it had in this one from the 1930s. And this is the way that the building looked when we came into the scene. The president of the college really wanted to make this a kind of three-in-one, a health center, a recreation center, and a student union all at once in this big, giant former coal-burning power plant. So I like to think of it as like a place that went from burning coal for students to burn calories. So in 2019, you can see how the building kind of added on over time to itself. And we added this field house and created a student union and gym inside the big powerhouse. And what unites it all is this kind of track. But the public aspect of this is really important. So in each project, I think it's important not to just take the brief as it is, but to think about how the architecture can extend beyond the boundaries of the brief and to give something to the public and make it possible. So in this case, I think you saw that image that the college is up on this hill and this potential public walkway along the Rock River is down here. And what we did was really bridge over this kind of highway and provide a public accessible elevator for anyone to use, anyone to be able to make this transition from high to low, low to high. So that's up in the front part of the building that is completely public. And in that case, it's like the building, which was a machine for generating power, is now a machine for generating equity and access. Inside, this track kind of combines all different uses inside. And then really using everything that's there to our advantage to create a very green building using the river water as a heat exchange and introducing new green roofs and spaces for gathering within the building and really reducing the overall energy use of the building. This is the way that this building was looking when we first arrived. It was in pretty bad shape, but you know, it's still such a giant building. And this is the building today. So it opened like just before the pandemic and then became really a kind of a great asset during this era of physical distancing because it's so big and allowed the students to still come in and engage without having to be in close proximity. So here's some of the views of it. I love this project in terms of like not throwing things away. Instead, how can they be reinvented and then make the community stronger overall? So what a great thing. And you know, there are dozens of these across the country that are that can no longer meet the regulations for clean air. And so they could either be a kind of detriment to their communities or they can be reinvented and make them stronger. So let's hope for the latter. This is the addition that we did, which is a sports practice area, but it can also have these big doors that open up and house the community, the city's jazz festival, and et cetera. This is the way over. It's a new bridge, actually. And here's the track inside that unites all the different spaces. And you can see the scale of it when it went from being like a kind of a building that housed a huge, you know, turbine to being a building that is really for people. And the students helped us actually to decide which elements to keep. And it was perfectly sized for its competition size pool in the first building there. And a major transformation. Okay, and then I wanted to talk about this kind of projects that don't have clients. Sometimes we do research projects. This happened to be a project about 5 years ago that we embarked on when there was these terrible stories of police brutality and killing and we were concerned and we wanted to explore if architecture could do anything to just, you know, anything at all to help to ameliorate some of these conflicts. And so this is just a mind map that I made of like how this stuff starts to formulate in my brain, in our brain. You know, sometimes it's individuals that are interested or universities that we're working with, things that happen, events like initiations, like the President Obama's task force that was launched to look at reforming police practices. And then it usually it ends up being a more organized attempt to make a project. And this could be a real project or a theoretical project, let's say, to address something that we care about. And in this case, it was really about, you know, creating better relationships between police and the communities that they serve. And a lot of it starts with research. This looks mind-boggling, I know, on a Zoom screen, but this is the history of policing in this country. It's not a one-size-fits-all. It is extremely different based on the geography, based on it's a fractured environment. It's not a federal police force. It's very local. So this is kind of based on, let's say, the Northeast and the history of how police stations actually came to be. Now, recognizing that a police station or is a publicly owned, you know, building, let's say. And so our idea was, what if this building could start to serve better, you know, instead of being a fortress, it could start to create better relationships. And so we looked at this history of the police station, from the watch boxes that were just for neighborhood, you know, watches, to these call stations, to these, like, later in the 60s, these fortress-like stations, and then how that impacts the urban realm, as you can see down below. So, I mean, this has got a lot of detail in it, and it took a lot of research to try to understand what was going on. And then we took a case study, like, let's say Chicago. There are these police stations that were all built around the same time, and they were prototypes. And each of them has a kind of jail inside, but they have a very high counter. They're very intimidating to go inside, even though they are new facilities. And then we looked in a specific neighborhood in North Lawndale where we picked a place where there was a lot of potential, like lots of youth and activity, but also an example of violence against community members. So, we looked here at the fabric of the urban realm. And then if you look at this blue area, you can see how urban renewal, the practice of removing buildings, had created a huge vacant area around this police station. So not only a very wide road, 130 feet wide, but also vast amounts of parking, which are never filled. And you can see this tearing through the fabric of this community. And so we asked ourselves, would it be possible to, because we weren't working for the police or the community, but we thought if we could bring those two groups together, what would the community want to see there? And what would the police want to see there? And how could they come together? Because one of the things we learned from the research was that the police don't know the people that they are policing. They live elsewhere. They're not connected, and they don't recognize the parents. They don't recognize the teens. So how to bring them together? And this was one of our workshops where we did combine a workshop, a visioning session for the station and the surrounding area. What would you like to see in your community? And we were looking for common things, and community members told us really interesting things, like, I would go in right now. They're very afraid to go anywhere near the police station, obviously. And, you know, they said things like, if it was a learning center, if it was a There were other city services there. If there was even a barbershop, those would be places where people could get to know each other. So this ended up inspiring us to kind of think about how policy, as represented in this task force on 21st century policing, could create a different kind of community. And so there were just different elements like housing for people with key service jobs, community gathering spaces, information sharing. This was really desired. Police station as a community center, like, you know, the thought that this is owned by the community would completely change a mindset. Innovation hub, wellness facilities. And after all of this, the kind of thing that was the easiest thing to pick off was like wellness and sport and using these big parking lots for something else. And so after doing this kind of urban plan, we zeroed in on this one spot to install, hopefully, a sport field. And it was amazing how many people wanted to see this investment. And really, this is the thing. I mean, right now, there's a lot of talk about disinvesting in the police. Well, that really means why not invest in the community and help the community to be stronger? And that's what this project was really about, was like giving something back to the community. A year later, we talked to people and they had changed attitudes. They wanted their kids to go there, and there was improvement. I'm not saying it's the solution to everything at all, because obviously it's very frustrating to not see things change. But in this one little case, there's like a little small step forward at least. And then finally, I wanted to just show this other project, which is kind of along the same lines. How can we utilize public assets, public space, public buildings to reinforce a community? So we're working in Memphis, and this is we were asked to re-envision this waterfront along the river, which has historically been taken over by infrastructure and by it was always, you know, kind of a loading zone, let's say, for the city. In fact, the city of Memphis faces onto what was called, well, Front Street. And this area back here was really like the dock. I mean, nothing. But now the city wants to reorient toward this Mississippi, this incredible, active, changing river. And so the project here is quite, the planning was quite vast along miles of this waterfront. And as we started in on it, we discovered various different parts, and the idea is to connect these parts to each other, but also back to the city at large. And one of the curious things we found was this place called Cobblestone Landing, this orange zone here. And it was just a kind of a dilapidated area, nothing really going on. But people had strong feelings about it one way or another as we engaged with the community. And this is a time when the city was also city and community activists were thinking about getting these Civil War statues down that were very offensive and in fact put up in the 1960s. So this area, this is what it looked like when we found this place, this Cobblestone Landing. And it turns out it has a very long storied history, very, very many different things happening here. It was even a place, it was a place for soldiers, World War I soldiers, to be returned to the city. It was a parking lot, but it was also a place where workers in the cotton industry worked. So that means that there were enslaved people that were working in this on this site. It was not a place for trade, but it was a place where people, enslaved people, worked. And so during this time, Tammy Sawyer, who was heading up the take them down about these monuments, we decided to think about like making this a public space that would be much more inclusive and starting to, you know, engage. And what would that look like? And so it was really about asking ourselves and the community, how can communities remake public space with complex histories? what do we do with this space? And in a way, it's really interesting because it's like a horizontal place. Could it be some kind of a marker? Could it be some kind of a place that recalls these complex histories? And so to do this process, there's really no rule book for this, but we just started to interview people. This is our team sketching and recording their stories. But these were community leaders from different parts of the city. And we took down stories from a variety of community leaders in the arts, in politics, in filmmaking, philanthropists, religious leaders, and started to record their stories. And really, Elmore Nickelberry here was amazing. He was a sanitation worker, but he had also marched with Dr. Martin Luther King. So he had great stories. And then we took these stories and we tried to embed these stories into those stones in the cobblestones. And so you can see here us kind of working on some of them, these cobblestones that were materials, different kinds of stone. We ended up telling these stories in the Venice Biennale. So that's like a long way away, but we shipped the story stones over there. And Italian masons installed them. So these stories got told to the international community. And the idea is they would come back and come back to Memphis and be an exhibit for the local people to share these stories. And now finally, we're working on another part of this waterfront called the Tom Lee Park. And Tom Lee was he was an African American man who saved a number of individuals who were whose boat tipped over in the Mississippi River. So this park is dedicated to them. And here, what we've tried to do for this engagement process is to engage young future designers, let's say, a Youth Design Leadership Council, to kind of help envision what they want to see in this place. So if you get the picture, what I'm trying to say is we need to engage more with people as architects, I think, and bring these visions to life and make it a process. And so this is an image of the future park, which is now under construction. And formerly it really had two uses, like a big barbecue festival and a concert venue. How do we make it a park for everyone all year round? And so these uses came out of these meetings with the community and working with the students. So it was always a working waterfront. So a lot of the inspiration are these kind of working waterfront architecture. And we have a number of various installations here, which are this canopy walk, which makes the park accessible to people with all different abilities. This is a kind of a universal pavilion that can be used for basketball, but also concerts and gathering. And this is all under construction. And then these concession areas for the park as well. So I call that actionable idealism, and I won't go into how that word came about, but maybe we could talk about it. But the idea that we can have idealistic goals, and we should, and then we can work toward those with step by step and to try to imagine this future that we all want. And so that is my talk for today.
Thank you, Jeanne, for your time and your insights and the wonderful pictures and the work that you're doing all over the world. Really exciting to see this.
Thank you.
So this concludes the 2099th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.